Hey, we're Mill and Colin.
We're backstage here at the Soundwave Festival in Australia. We're out doing a 10-year anniversary tour of an album we released over a decade ago.
We did a show in our hometown, Örebro, and we thought that maybe we should do something different here. And we decided to play the Panavish Pioneers album from start to finish. It was very fun to do this, and we booked some other shows.
Canada, then South America, Central America, now we're here in Australia.
We have a European tour and some summer festivals. Even more dates in Europe, and we never know when this is going to end.
Why the Panavish album?
I guess our fans like that album the most. It's one of our biggest albums so far, you know, and it was actually that album that took us to the next level. This thing is for us, it's like playing a new album, in a way, because half of the album has never been played live before, so it's a new situation, experience, and that makes it more fun to do this.
The feeling you get when you walk up on stage, you know, it's the greatest. New DVD? Yeah, we've been talking about this for a long time. I don't know if it's gonna be a regular sequel to the Hyatt Adventures. We actually filmed a lot during the recording.
Yeah, I think there's footage when we're driving to the airport in Stockholm on our way to LA.
The whole idea to record the album in Los Angeles with Brett was a really big thing for us. Those bands that Brett had produced before were albums that were the reason that we started Millencolin.
Us growing up, Epitaph was, you know, the coolest record label there was. Pretty much all the records were recorded at West Beach Recorders in Hollywood by either Donnell Cameron or Brett Gurewitz.
Yeah, like a dream come true and sort of fulfilling the circle.
First of all, it was a big, big, big adventure to do this. I mean, we had been touring the US many times before. We never actually, you know, went there and stayed there at the same place for like 6 or 8 weeks that we did this time.
The first thing we did in the morning, I remember, was going to a place called Cole's.
Epitaph rented a place for us to rehearse, and we were supposed to meet up with Brett the first day, but he never showed up. So we rehearsed on our own, and later on he showed up the other day, and we rehearsed the songs for maybe 2 or 3 days.
We were hoping that those 3 days would change the songs into masterpieces. Brett came up with some ideas, really cool ideas, but maybe those 3 days of rehearsing weren't that productive.
The rehearsing was mostly about playing chess and blues jamming.
It was a great way of like easy start to work with Brett before we entered the real studio.
Hi, I'm looking for West Beach. West Beach? Okay, right this way.
You kind of imagine it to be like a palace or something, you know. You expect it to be huge. And West Beach is a really, really great studio, but like all studios pretty much, I mean, they are kind of small. There is a tracking room. West Beach tracking room is great with all the acoustics and stuff. The control room, kind of small, but a good room. And then, of course, a little, you know, hanging out area, which is like a couch, a TV, and a coffee machine. But that's pretty much all you need.
You know, it was back in 1999, so as you can see in the footage, there's no computers. There's not a computer screen in the whole studio. So everything was recorded on two-inch 24-track tape machines. So, and they were singing together, so we had 48 tracks.
Material Boy has a certain reference to Madonna, her song Material Girl. I guess it's some critique to the way people are consuming things in today's society.
We've been playing it a lot live.
Yeah.
That's one of the songs we pretty much always played live, not just on this 10-year anniversary tour.
No. It's been one of those songs that we always played live from Thunder's Pioneers. Material Boy ends out in the start of Duck Pond.
I don't know if we have those kind of songs before. Duck Pond is Millencolin trying to do something more emotional.
It's definitely like the new sound of old Pennybridge Pioneers.
Yeah.
We didn't have any songs like that on the previous albums.
No.
Duck Pond, that's the small pond that the ducks swim in. And yeah, I guess it's about seeing the world as bigger than the pond. I don't know.
All right, it goes like this.
Wobbling the line, two pumps along the royal. Now I'm leaving the heart, talk of ashes through the sidewalks of the moon. By the river coin, not being if I was royal. Spirit, next time I'll be out. Six battles and food.
this town and for me. You got the burning flame, the shirt shooter in. You don't stop for me to see. Oh, I wish that I could do the same as that and go. Just pack my bags and goodbye. Get off that slow, fade away from slow. It's what you see as what you get right. Another day, shut to the night, the misery. Those hideaways are wounded, like a cloudy eye to eye. No matter where I could be, all right to go. I'm stuck here, that's a fact. What you see as what you got right. We're changes, no worries. What you see as what you got right.
Before this, we had released 3 albums. We've been touring constantly since something like 94 till 98. And we never took a break. We just were out on the road the whole time. Got back, wrote songs, recorded again, and then back out on the road. So we were, after a while, we were kind of, you know, coming back to the same club somewhere in the world for the 4th time or something. It felt like we'd done everything.
And I just felt that we need to slow down this thing a little bit. Personally, I felt that I needed some time away from the band. So I told the other guys in the band that I wanted to take a break. Not to end the band, but just take a break. I think we all actually needed to focus a bit on other stuff too, to get perspective on what the band meant to us. And
I don't think too many people knew that we actually were on a break from the band.
And it just took like half a year after we had made a break that we sort of felt that we wanted to do a new Millen Collin album. As soon as we decided to, okay, let's make a new album, we felt that we needed to do the new album in a different way than the 3 first ones.
This was the perfect thing to get Millen Collin back on track again.
I have a card for you, gentlemen. Brett Gurwitz, West Beach Recorders.
Thank you very much.
Pleased to meet you, Brett Gurwitz, West Beach Recorders. I'm a recording
Thank you very
engineer.
Much, sir.
Excuse me. And let's get a shot of this award-winning presentation.
It's always a little bit nervous when you're going to start to work with somebody. Somebody's going to produce you. You never know if the guy is going to be, you know, a soft, cool guy or the hard-ass guy who's telling you that you suck if you miss some takes and stuff. And, I mean, we knew Brett before, but we never worked with him, you know. But he ended up like the perfect producer for Millen Collin, because we really need like a 5th band member more than a guy telling you to do stuff.
Hi, not that hi-hat is ever a problem here at West Beach, of course, where hi-hat making never occurs.
Donnell was kind of like a legendary guy for us. We never seen a picture of him or anything, so we didn't know what to expect, but you know, he was always like had a producer or engineering credit on all the albums we love. Great guy, really, really nice guy, kind of quiet, sticking to himself a little bit, and he was pretty much doing all the dirty work with, you know, attaching cables and stuff, and also recording stuff. But Brett was the producer, and so Don was more like an assistant to Brett during this recording. The recording process of this album was a little bit different to us because, like always, we first tracked the drums and then bass, the guitars, and then guitar melodies, solos, and then we're going into the vocals, followed by backup vocals and some extras maybe.
Okay, Larson, are you ready?
But this time around, we first started out when we were tracking the drums, like everybody in the band were in the room playing together to get the right feel. And sometimes it ended up with just being like one guy playing guitars with Larson and stuff. But for the most part, everybody in the band were playing alongside of Larson when he was tracking the drums.
Hey, bro, Larson.
Good.
There it is.
We got a take.
Oops, there it is.
The song Hell Man is actually a song that is kind of similar to Duck Pond. It's the same, has the same structure. It probably has the same influences also, and it's a good song.
For this 10-year anniversary tour we're doing right now of Pennybridge Pioneers, this is one of the songs which is the first time performing this one live.
Yeah, it is.
No matter how I feel for you, the three words I can't say. I regret the times I used the word okay. I do my shit needs. People show they really care. But the value in honesty, I'm quite aware. Still there's my shit needs that I don't share. Learn your guys to say what I think. I'm too scared. Learn your guys to say what I think. I saw me a younger player. I'm afraid of getting too comfort. The fairy tale you know. Though I know this weakness keeps me low. So much inside me that I don't show. And you got to say what?
Stop to think, how about the drums?
It was a hazard to record that song. That song and Highway Donkey was really hard for me. Somehow I lost the D beat. I couldn't play fast that time. I don't know what happened, but I think most drummers go through that sometimes, that you just freak out. And this was probably because of pressure. The drums needed to be finished first to be able to continue with the recording, and the clock is ticking, the money's ticking, and I didn't feel very good. I had some personal problems, but alcohol made me do it. I had to get drunk to record that song. It turned out okay.
Yo, Brett.
Yes.
They're talking to you.
Hello. Go out there and hit the snare for me.
So you record one snare hit?
Yeah, we'll just have him punch that hit, you know?
At that exact time?
Right now, like an overdub.
Okay.
And on a different track.
Okay.
Then when he gets it,
oh, yeah.
Then I'll bounce it onto the snare track. Mm-hmm. But.
Okay. Yeah, we didn't. He didn't know.
Hit the snare. Good. Yeah, hit it like that. What do you bounce it over to two for?
Okay.
You do the hard part.
And as I told before, there was no digital editing available at all on this album.
Usually I do the hard part, but I just don't feel like it.
So you could edit, he actually took the reel with the 2-inch tape, and he could be just listening for a, you know, a kick snare.
Yeah.
And he could, like, cut it.
Sink head.
He was cutting it up with a razor blade and taping, you know, get it together with maybe a different take. We didn't really do much of that, but some stuff, he was really, really cool with that. You never wanted me to go. You didn't dare to let me know that what could turn back to my. So he knew that old technique that I don't think many people is using that. No, people don't do that anymore.
Yes,
I
heard that.
You're the king, Donald. You're the king.
Thank you very much. It makes me look good.
Eight edits, at least.
And in the Bad Religion records, man, we had to cut, like, tom fills.
Fills.
We cut in the middle of tom fills, like, you get the first part of the fill.
Wait, he's recording this.
Oh, shit.
Just kidding. Never about Bad Religion.
No, it wasn't Bad Religion.
Just kidding about Bad Religion, you guys.
Bad Religion was never...
Always played the drums just right, and he was a very good drummer. Those guys in Bad Religion were excellent musicians all around.
Yeah. Professional style.
Yes, absolutely.
That's right.
So terrible.
That's right. What? Did you hear that? Go play bass. Speaking of sounding terrible.
Highway Donk was the same story for me. I hated recording that song.
Nevertheless, Highway Donk is a cool song. And a quite extraordinary song for at least two reasons. One being you're doing the only backup
I think it's
vocals.
The only song through all these years.
Yeah.
I did backup too.
And then the other reason why it's a bit special is Brett himself is playing a guitar solo, which is quite cool that he made that contribution, and it's like classic Bad Religion solo.
Can we hear from the top?
Jesus. Good job, man. Yeah. Fucking rock and roll.
Are we done?
Har vi en punklåt på skivan också? Säljer vi till kids.
We haven't played that song that much through the years.
No.
But I like playing it now. We'll be right back.
a good song, Nicola.
Luna! Luna!
We all stayed in a place called Oakwood, which was like a gated community where you could rent like apartments, and I guess a lot of people from the Hollywood movie business were staying there, like actors and such people.
It was like a 2-bedroom apartment.
Trying to have some like live like a normal life.
It was like family life with the dudes.
Every morning you wake up, cook some breakfast with the guys, heading down to the gym or the pool before we took off.
The only thing that was bad about the place we stayed at, it was kind of far from the studio, so you couldn't really, you had to drive there.
Go down to the studio in a rented car, down on the 101, and then go up on Hollywood Boulevard and into the studio.
The studio is located at Hollywood Boulevard. So, I mean, we were right in the middle of where stuff is happening. During the recording, we're always, you know, trying to come up with ideas what to call the album. And I think during this recording, the working title was Oakwood.
The name of our new album, Oakwood.
Based on where we were staying in Burbank. But I don't think it was until we got back home to Sweden somebody came up with the Pennybridge Pioneers. Pennybridge is our hometown's name directly translated into English, Örebro. And Pioneers because we are the first band from our hometown to make it outside of Sweden, pretty much.
We worked a lot with the guitar sound. We had, I think it was 4 amps running at the same time. I mean, it was probably eight microphones recording guitar sound, you know, at the same time. So it's a lot of stuff, but we mixed everything before it went down on tape.
I like it!
Woo! I think we brought one guitar each for this recording. I brought my black Stratocaster, the one I used on pretty much all the recordings. And Matthias brought a Gibson, I believe. I also bought a white Stratocaster during the recording.
New guitar, huh?
Oh, yeah.
And Brett brought in a couple of guitars, like a really, really expensive Telecaster called I think it's called a Nocaster, before they even named it Telecaster or something. We used that a lot on especially like the non-distorted parts. It sounded really good with like the crunch sound. He also brought his famous Red Rocker, the guitar he uses a lot with Bad Religion. It's like a red guitar. I can't remember which brand it is, but it sounds really, really good with a more powerful distorted sounds.
Yes.
Good.
We got it.
Good.
It starts with the chorus.
Huh?
It starts with the chorus, the song.
No.
It doesn't start
with that.
Right there, go chicka 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 chicka.
Yeah, and then after that, the chorus comes.
Punch it right there.
Yeah, punch it. The second figure, the chorus.
Okay.
After.
It was a little bit more rock-oriented. I had started to listen to a lot more rock and roll. I mean, more like garage rock and stuff like that.
The rock song, yeah. I think that song happened because we were hanging out with the Peep Shows, and that's where I took the title from. It was sort of like a homage or hello to those guys.
I guess Nicola had this song too acoustically, and we made it more rockish in the rehearsing room. It's a short and a good song. It fits very good on the album where it is.
It's a good song playing live too. When you write the songs and rehearse the songs, you always have like a working title before the real lyrics are written. So a lot of the songs before we went to the States were called different stuff on the demo. Like A10, for example, by some reason it was called the Plink song.
Yeah, the Plink song.
And
also the song Hellman was called the Bridge song.
If you check out the Epitaph webpage and a lot of like online music stores, the working titles are still there on some songs.
As the song titles. Yeah. So yeah. Instead of Hellman, it's Bridge Song.
And A10, it's still Plink Song.
Yeah.
Oh, the Plink Song.
Oh, yeah.
Very emotional and sort of a sad song, sad story. And I like playing that song live, and I like the song on the album too. Brett came up with the idea of adding the solo, the guitar solo that Eric later played. Brett said it. We need a solo here. And it turned out to be a good idea. I heard some kind of solo in my head. I'm not sure if I tried to describe that to Eric, but when I came in, the solo was finished. And when I heard it, I was like, because it was quite different than what I had heard in my head. I wasn't happy then, but then after a while, I realized that that solo is actually pretty good. But I guess that just tells that some of you have an idea of something, and when it's not the way you think it, you know, would be, or it doesn't mean that it's bad. You can later find out that it's actually something good.
Anyways.
In the process of recording an album, usually what you do is you record drums, bass, guitars, like you add everything on, and then after that it's time for vocals, and that's where I come in.
Damn, give me some effect, man, right away, coming up.
And usually it's a process and a time period that's a lot of pressure, and because usually I don't have the lyrics ready. Maybe I have like a third or half of the lyrics written before we enter the studio. And then once in the studio, I know that I have to get the lyrics done. No Cigar was the last song to be written before the album. It wasn't even included in the demos that we sent to Brett. The lyrics was written the night before, like between midnight and 2 o'clock in the morning. I was desperate trying to get the lyrics done because I knew that I had to sing the song the next day, so.
If you think it's spell, I would tell you that you're close, but no cigar.
It's always been a certain pressure on recording the vocals, especially, but it's also a bit refreshing that you actually write the lyrics almost when you're singing it. You're sort of living the lyrics in a way, I guess.
Tell us where you're from, what do you want to become, and we'll say if you're okay. Did you go to school? Right answer, are you cool? Kid all day, sticker in your face, information about your case, so you know your potential. The things you can't stand, the things you can't stand, just comprehend. But I don't wanna hear it.
Are you okay with doing this for a minute?
Sure, no
are
problem.
You sure? You sure you are?
Yeah, of course. It's no problem. Okay. Listen up. Hang on, Tip.
Tell us where you're from, what you want to become, and we'll say if you're okay. Yeah, you're the kid all day.
Det sitter ju, du.
Ja.
Då klipper jag in efter det. Ja, kör igen. Så jag kanske pratar tillbaka lite längre.
Men var? Ja, så här ska jag gå för det. I don't wanna hear it. It's more than I accept. Ja, och vilken paus är du med? Nej, lugna dig lite. Lugna ner dig lite. Men det måste ju finnas en melodi liksom.
Recording vocals is not something that I look forward to. It's especially punk rock vocals is like physically exhausting because I get such a headache.
Stop. I'm not sure.
When Nicola is doing the vocals, he is getting tons of headaches because he's like, he's always pushing himself to, you know, the limit where as high as his voice can reach pretty much. So he's getting a little bit annoyed the whole time, and so it's not too popular that we're sitting there in the control room, you know, with all our ideas and stuff, and it's a sensitive moment.
To me, No Cigar is one of those songs that defines the change of our style, I think. That song was very important for us.
Yeah.
I don't think any of us thought that it would be such an influential song.
No.
To other bands and to people.
I had like a riff idea, and that song is kind of specific with the drum beat. It actually marked, it was like the start of a new era for Millencolin, especially the drum pattern and the whole structure of the song was something I haven't never done before.
No Cigar, Penguins and Polar Bears, I believe, with the guitar riffs was something that Matthias came up with, which sort of added to our new sound quite a lot, I think.
I think a lot of people got into that song from the game Tony Hawk Pro Skater 2, which was a big deal at the time.
Yeah.
And I think that really actually did a lot for that song.
Alright, here we go.
Devil Me. It's one of those songs too that we didn't really play live before, but it's basically because it's very high in pitch for Nicola to sing.
The song was so too high for me to sing, because I've been singing for days and I was really sore in my throat and I couldn't hit the high notes.
We actually had to pitch the tape down just some sense to make it a little bit easier for him to reach the highest key.
Lyric wise, inspired by a band called Fishbone, and they have a song called Devil You, Slick Nick, Devil You. I had a nickname called Slick Nick, automatically thought that hey, I must write a song called Devil Me because I'm Slick Nick, and that's what I did. I'm just mentioning a bunch of things in my life at the time that I was around me and things that I was doing and loving and caring about, and simple as that. Yes, I'm a Yugoslav Nikita Sweet. Got your brothers, girlfriend, dad and mom. Your books are short, tiny. Lots of maps I read. And I would love to run my own farm.
I like the Beatles, funk and punk. I watch Rossi, Bubba, Popeye, Chess. I eat veggie junk, I love Super Chunk. Cool and Travis say yes. All this I adore, but it's anxiety just for me.
Kids, this is Brett from Epitaph, and here's a song that I made with them called Penguins and Polar Bears from the upcoming record.
Nicola?
Yeah.
Let's finish up here, man. This part is good. Let's do it on the rest of the choruses.
I'm on the top when... It's a perfect note for a background.
Okay. Isn't that low? A low note is... something low.
Yeah.
There still is a harmony between that low, that harmony, and that... And the lead.
Oh, there is?
That's what I sang before.
Yeah, but it didn't sound any good.
No.
Na 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 na.
But the low sound kind of funny on that.
Na 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 na.
Let's hear that with the one we have.
La 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 la.
That harmony on the first one, and then the lower on the I don't know. I don't like you, you don't like me.
Okay, so there's two-part harmony in each one.
And the lead and...
And one voice. Yeah. Okay, good. So we'll replace the first one.
I think he saw us as a good band that had a lot of skills. Maybe we didn't realize that we had all those skills as musicians and singers or whatever, and songwriters. And I think we realized that during that time.
Okay, yeah. Yeah. All we need is, you sang the low harmony on the second line on the high track.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you sing the high harmony on the second one. Did you do it?
Yeah. You're the top when I am low.
One of his good skills was that he pushed us, not only with backups but with the playing and a lot of things and the vocals. He pushed us and he made us realize that we were maybe better than we thought.
when we came to LA.
For me, I feel like Penguins and Clovers and No Cigar are connected in one way, because they have this drum beat. I wrote that riff, and it's a bit different from what we've done before, and also the chord changes are a bit different than what we're used to doing. And it's a very powerful song, and it's one of the best of the album.
Well, the song is about, I guess, how people get into different roles. If one role is taken, then you know the other person automatically gets into the sort of opposite, the anti-pole role thing. Polar bears from the North Pole and the penguins from the South Pole, where you won't find any penguins in the North Pole and equally no polar bears in the South Pole.
We immediately, I think already when we left Sweden, we kind of pictured this song to be the first single. And we choose this one to be the first single and video. We went to the States just to shoot this video with a Swedish video crew. We started that day super early in the morning,
yeah.
And we drove off to the beach, I think, Marina del Rey.
It might have been, yeah. But we did those, we shot those scenes where Nicola is running from the ocean.
Yeah.
Camera, action. Nine.
Basically, each member was supposed to be like one of the four elements, and I was the wind, right?
You were representing the wind, yeah. I was representing water. Water boy.
Fire.
Fire. I'm earth.
Dust. Maybe it's hard for people to get this, but it was the director's idea, and we bought it.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes you don't have to have the best idea in the world. I mean, this video works because it looks really good. It's got great footage.
I think we shot the video in one day. Usually when you make a video, you shoot everything in one day because everything is so expensive to rent, and so you usually get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and you go to bed at 4 o'clock in the morning again.
The video is shot on so many different locations around LA.
I've been running for sure.
We're driving around several sites.
It was a very long and hectic day.
And this was in December.
Right before Christmas,
Right before Christmas. And we had such a luck with the weather because it was like, looks like in the middle of the summer, and it was really hot too. When you are shooting in Hollywood, you need like a filming permit. And of course, we didn't have this because it costs a fortune. So the scenes shot on Hollywood Boulevard were like sneaky shot, pretty much. It was funny, the clip where I'm emptying my pockets is kind of funny because I was just amongst tons of people, and I was just like emptying my pockets of dirt. And people are just looking at me, what the fuck?
Yeah, because it was shot from remote. We shot some scenes in an alley at the end of the video, where all the elements get together.
Yeah.
I think it was people who wanted to get paid to allow us to be there.
Yeah.
Maybe it was even the cops that we paid off. I don't remember.
We might have paid off a cop in that alley.
We don't know where we are.
Downtown LA is a weird place to be. It sort of reminds me of The Escape from New York, parts of it.
Larson did some crazy running on top of a roof in downtown LA and down like a fire stairs. It was kind of scary, I remember. It doesn't look scary on the video, but we were really...
No, in real life it was much worse. Yeah. I mean,
there was no fences, and it was...
I was watching it and I was like, This is dangerous. I mean, if you would have, you know, just slipped a little bit, you would have fallen. Ah, who knows what would happen? And I was like, is it just me who thinks that this is too dangerous to actually do?
The people, the weird people that came out of the windows, was the most scariest part.
Yeah, I am.
Because I got so surprised.
Larson.
Larson's here. Good job, man.
Fucking awesome job, dude.
Hey, fine, so I'm looking good though.
Yeah, keep it still there.
Cut! All the live footage is really crazy. I mean, people might think that we shot this against a green screen, but this is the real deal. We're on the top of like a really tall hotel building. Behind Larsson, there's, you know, some serious meters down to the ground. And then as the background, we have downtown LA, the Staples Arena and stuff. It was an amazing shoot.
Let's roll, man. Everybody's ready? Camera ready? Ready? Okay. Lock on target. Action!
I think we've almost been awake and shooting for 24 hours straight when we performed this live performance.
See you later, downtown Los Angeles.
Had a certain time there in the studio, so we kind of realized that, oh, we only have like 3 days here, maybe we won't have time to put backup vocals on all the songs. Okay, we have 3 days for backup, so let's do as many songs as we have time to. I mean, for instance, the ballad, there's no backup vocals on that one.
Fox, which maybe is for the better too, because maybe you will have a bigger diversity between the songs, where you have some songs that are more naked with just one lead vocals.
The Mayfly, it has some rhythm in the verse.
Groovy. No, it was based on a riff I had.
It's a good song, and actually it stands out on this album that it's very different from the other stuff too.
We tried to play the Mayfly live once in Salt Lake City, I remember, and we were like, whoa, this doesn't work, because it's get a slower tempo than we're used to.
Felt strange.
It felt really strange when the crowd kind of like mellowed off, but playing it now you realize that it's good live too, to turn down the tempo a little bit.
You notice that Nicola can't play today because he lost the chess game.
Yeah.
Have you noticed that?
Once in a while we would take breaks. Brett would say, I think we need a chess break. And me and Brett, since we're both chess fans, we would play a few games of chess, and which for me was quite fun. But in the long run, over these weeks or whatever we were in the studio, maybe those chess breaks were a few too many, I don't know. but I had fun.
Man,
snurrar så satans
jävla Herbalife, man. Oh,
seriöst det här, så att någon kan snart hem till Sverige.
We got some bugs here. Later.
Det blev knäckt. Han tog gubben som ska producera det här. Han spelar hellre schack och ligger och berättar dåliga historier.
One of those positive songs, exactly. One of those sort of pep songs, as we call them, pepper. It's supposed to be a pepper. I like the melodies, and I think the song has been played maybe faster on the recording than we played live.
I don't think so.
Okay.
Okay. It's insanely fast.
Live.
Played live.
Okay.
Fox was a song that Nicola had written all acoustic, that we made more, you know, melancholish in the rehearsing room.
It's one of those happy poppy songs that has always been a part of the melancholy sound, I guess. And the lyrics about my scooter, and not about a girl, because that would be quite weird.
It was also the second single and the second video from that one. I remember that we shot this right before we started a US tour.
Yeah, the Punkorama tour.
Yeah, and we worked with the same guys who did the Penguins and Polar Bears video.
Yeah.
I guess I'm playing myself, basically. Buying a scooter and then driving around town and meeting weird people.
That was that tough guy at the yard sale.
Yeah, exactly. Why were you a tough guy when you were trying to sell your stuff?
Right? I mean, I am a tough guy. It was me.
Selling in the skateboard.
Yeah.
Put the camera, like,
Okay. Okay, camera up.
Speed.
Action.
Hey, we'll break for a half hour, you guys.
I don't know. People think like this business is kind of like a shrimp sandwich, like that. Whole thing is just like straight down the shrimp sandwich, you know. But I tell you, man, it's a lot of hard work we're doing here. And I'm fucking damn proud of it, man. Here you got avocados, got cucumbers, got lettuce, tomatoes. You know, it's not all shrimp sandwich, man.
The scooter I was riding, I mean, my scooter back home is very simple. It's automatic. You just go. The one that they found at the end was a really old thing that was really hard to start, and to put getting the gears were I had big problems.
And I worked at a drive-through burger joint.
Yeah. Perfect. Yeah. Okay, ready, guys? Just focus now. Happy face, man.
Happy face. Happy me. Okay, camera. Please. And action. Here we go, man. Making videos has always been a fun part. It's the closest to acting one can get. Well, would not be an actor.
I was supposed to be this tough guy in a pickup truck, but I don't think anyone noticed that. It just looks like me. Yeah, when we were standing at those traffic lights, you on the scooter and me in the pickup truck, I just drove without looking.
Okay.
And I almost crashed into a car from opposite direction.
Oh, okay. Some videos there are more performance videos, and then you have like the acting videos, and this one is almost only acting, so I think that it was a lot of fun. Done demos of my ideas
for the songs, and they were all acoustic. A lot of the songs on this album ended up not being acoustic, of course, since we're a punk band.
It was actually a song that it wasn't really finished when we got to the US. We never demoed the song either. We just had some acoustic guitars with Nicholas singing it. So we actually worked this song a lot.
He told Larson, he told the whole band, like, I hear clock ticking. And we were like, what? Play like this. And that's how we came up with the intro part for the ballad.
It was one of those songs that we were kind of scared of in a way, because it was so different for a punk rock band to do this on an album.
But I think we were, not everyone in the band had agreed on if we should have it on the album, because it wasn't like a real fast punky song. In the end, we decided to have it on the album. I was insisting on that. I'm very happy that it made the album. Yeah.
Sounds like a record, huh? Nothing too quiet. Sounds fucking good, man.
Maybe it's one of those songs that it's quite easy to relate to, because I think everyone in life, at some situation or, you know, time in their life, has felt to be like outside of where they wanted to be. So it's a song that anyone can relate to, and I think that's why, you know, it's meaningful to a lot of people.
Last selection in the ball game does never get a pass. Not appreciate just his first name. He's the scapegoat of the class. There are no friends to cheer him up, and no girls, no sweet romance. And it's impossible to expect when you never get a second chance. Do you know? Well, he's not going to the school prom. He said he had the flu. Trumped up excuses as he told mom. Well, I'm safer here with you. She told her son someday they'll all be sorry for mistreating you. Don't be afraid, my son, but trust me, you'll be someone they will look up to. So do you know? We'll be right back.
be that same. Cheers.
We're tuning, dude.
We're tuning, dude. Play something fast.
This one is fast.
You guys are the fastest.
Well, it's...
I like punk because it's fast.
Good app, huh?
I'm more punk than you.
Tell me about it.
We're in Sao Paulo, and we're doing the last show of this tour, and we got our crazy helmet cams on, so we're gonna shoot a couple of these songs live. Let's see how it works out. We look like idiots. Wow.